Hey guys, I'm here watching South Park. Let's get technical. The cable company that allows me to watch South Park on TV right now is Comcast. If, instead of wanting to watch South Park, I wanted to watch, say, BoJack Horseman on Netflix or Bo Burnham on YouTube, I'd have to use an internet connection provided to me by Comcast. Comcast is my only option when it comes to my ISP, and if you live in America, you probably don't have that many options either. The Federal Communications Commission reports that 96% of Americans have two or fewer options when it comes to cable broadband ISPs. A matter of fact, people have even made maps on what your ISP likely is based on the state you live in. Not to mention, with all the net neutrality stuff going on right now, it's got me thinking, how do we even get here in the first place? Today, let's find out how internet and cable companies got regional monopolies in the United States. Let's do some time traveling. In 1948, the first cable systems in the US were put into place in parts of Arkansas, Oregon, and Pennsylvania, but cable companies didn't really take off until the 1970s and 80s. Why did it take so long for them to get popular? Two reasons. First, the FCC put a ton of restrictions on cable in its early years because OG broadcast networks felt threatened by cable companies. Before cable, television networks themselves would just send a signal to your TV, but when cable came along, networks viewed them as a middleman who stole their shows and then forced people to pay for content they were already getting. So, after lots of complaining, the FCC eventually put in rules to restrict cable. And a lot of them. So the FCC won't let me be, or let me be me, so let me see. And cable did see.
Wait, what does that mean?
I don't know, I'm just trying to make a good transition. In 1972, after the public voiced disapproval of all the cable regulations, the FCC started to loosen them. This was the first reason cable took off in the 70s. The other? Well, it was actually HBO. But it wasn't their programming, it was their technology. HBO was also founded in 1972, and they took advantage of the loosening of FCC restrictions, specifically the 1975 ruling that cable companies could use satellites for their broadcasting. This tech would work by sending a signal from a satellite to massive 30-foot dish-shaped antennas across the country, which would then send signals through the cables into your home. HBO was the first to take advantage of this new technology when they broadcast the Muhammad Ali versus Joe Frazier fight. The fight took place in Manila, but it was broadcast all around the world. It really was a thrilla in Manila. And not just because the title was literally Thrilla in Manila. The fight was a huge success, which meant HBO wanted to do more of that. So naturally, they sued the FCC, which resulted in even more loosening of restrictions. Those two factors spurred the growth of cable. In the 1960s, cable only had around 850,000 US subscribers, but at the end of the 1980s, cable had 53 million US subscribers. To put that in perspective, that's a 62 times increase. That's going from only the silver play button to PewDiePie level. This huge growth led to Congress passing the Cable Communications Act of 1984. This is where our story begins. The Cable Communications Act of that's way too long. Let's just call it the CA. The CA did a lot of things, but most importantly, it gave cities themselves the authority to create exclusive partnerships between their city and cable companies. Basically, cities would strike up deals with cable companies like this.
Hey there, beautiful San Francisco!
Stop pandering.
Okay.
How about we make this little, deal-y? We're willing to wire your entire town. That's right, every corner, every house gets cable. It's a huge selling point for your town, plus your current residents will love it.
I do like that, but... Wait a sec, what's in it for you?
It'll just give us, like, a complete monopoly over the city for the next 12 to 15 years. But don't worry, this is completely essential. You know, we need that time to properly lay down the cables, and, you know, we want to make sure that we're the ones doing it.
Well, obviously that plan seems great, not like it's gonna blow up in our face later.
We accept. Good doing business with you. Cable companies would go around snatching up monopolies over cities, creating the birth of the oligopoly we have today. Unfortunately, when Congress realized the damage they did with the CA, it was too late. In 1992, Congress passed the Cable Television Consumer Protection and Competition Act, making those sort of monopoly deals illegal, but at that point, it was too late to fix the damage or even change anything.
Why?
Let me tell you about it. The cable industry now had something called a natural monopoly. What's that?
It's when you make a monopoly board out of only compostable parts.
Yeah. Wait, what? No. There are two types of costs that are relevant to our discussion. Fixed costs and marginal costs. Fixed costs are costs that stay consistent. They don't change depending on how many customers you have, and it's essential to have whatever you're spending your fixed costs on, even if you only have one customer. Among many other things, the biggest fixed cost in the cable industry is
Well, the cables. You have to lay them down no matter how many customers you get. Then, on the other hand, we have marginal costs. This is how much it costs to hook up another person with your product. This cost is not necessarily consistent, it can change depending on the scale of your company. For the cable industry, that cost is pretty small. I mean, you have to send out a cable box and whatnot, but that's not crazy expensive. A natural monopoly is when an industry has an extremely high fixed cost, but a much lower, fairly consistent marginal cost. Elaborating on what I previously said, it's crazy expensive to lay down cables and give a city access to your internet and TV, but it's pretty consistently cheap to send out cable boxes and for the occasional technician to come to your home. To bring this explanation home, let's take a look at an example. You live in the city, totally legit Cityopolis, where, because of the laws previously mentioned, you only have one ISP, Charter. You want to change that, so you start a new cable company. What do you actually have to do to sell internet? Well, first you have to get a ton of permits. It's tricky and long, but assuming you can do that, then comes the hard part. You have to lay down cable. You can't use the cables that are already there, those are Charter's cables. They laid them down and they own them. Unfortunately, as you might expect, laying down cables is very expensive. You have a massive fixed cost. I couldn't find one exact number on how much it costs to lay down cable, but I did find this chart from the US Department of Transportation, which makes me think that it's somewhere between $21,000 and $52,000 per mile, which, let me just say, you could buy a lot of comedically large coffee cups with that money. At this point, you have one of two options. You could either realize you don't have enough money and call it quits, or somehow get enough money to lay down cables, and then, well, try to make a profit. Most of the city is already on Charter, which means you'd have to offer lower prices than them just to get only around 10 to 20% of the population of the city on your plan, according to Gizmodo. Moreover, Charter would just see that some of their customers are leaving, so they would just drop their prices lower than yours to get those people to come back. And yes, that does provide a temporary relief to consumers, you know, competition brings pricing that benefits buyers, but sooner or later, you're gonna be out of business because you have too few customers paying too low a price. Charter's gonna go back to being a monopoly, prices rise, and we're back to where we started. In this scenario, your cable startup took a massive loss, and it's the reason why no one, or at least very few people, attempt to compete with existing cable companies. No one wants to suffer that outcome, and thus, a natural monopoly is formed. Heck, cable companies themselves aren't even willing to compete with each other. John Oliver pointed this out in a segment on Net Neutrality a couple years ago when he showed this clip of Comcast CEO Brian Roberts talking about the issue at the Recode Code conference.
Both in video and in broadband, we don't compete with Time Warner. You have to start with that very fundamental point. They're in New York. We're in Philadelphia, they're in LA, we're in San Francisco. You can't buy a Comcast in New York, you can't buy a Time Warner in Philadelphia.
Anyways, now that we've covered what a natural monopoly is, let's jump back to where we left off, the Cable Television Consumer Protection and Competition Act of 1992. So now, if you're the cable industry and you're just hit with tighter regulation, what do you do? Merge! Merge like crazy! Merge to your heart's content! This course article does a really good job of illustrating the mergers, but long story short, in 24 years, between 1993 and 2017, what was previously 40 cable companies merged into just 3, Charter, Comcast, and Cox. So, where do we go from here? Let's talk about net neutrality. This is Ajit Pai. He's the chairman of the Federal Communications Commission, and recently he voted to repeal net neutrality.
The chair votes aye. The item is adopted with editorial privileges granted as requested.
For those unaware, net neutrality is the concept that ISPs must provide equal access to everything on the internet regardless of where it comes from. Essentially, ISPs can't play favorites when deciding on what content to deliver to you. In the same way your local water company can't say, hey, using our water for toilets will be an extra $9.99 a month, net neutrality blocks ISPs from saying, hey, using our internet for YouTube will be an extra $9.99 a month. That's the brief explanation, click the I to see a longer ViHeart video explaining it more. Ajit Pai believes that getting rid of net neutrality, among other things, will encourage competition and more choices for the consumer. But we know that's not true, because we just saw how ISPs got and maintained these monopolies. Eliminating net neutrality isn't going to magically change any of that. A matter of fact, the only reason net neutrality laws exist at all is because there is no competition. If ISPs didn't have regional monopolies in the US, then competition and capitalism would encourage ISPs to not throttle or block the internet, because if they did, you could just switch to a competitor who didn't. Luckily, just because the FCC repealed net neutrality, it doesn't mean the fight is over. As the famous battleforthenet.com says, Congress can stop this by passing a resolution of disapproval to overturn the FCC vote. If you want to help preserve net neutrality, click the I to go to battleforthenet.com and tell Congress your thoughts. And maybe, one day, we can get Jack to legally change his name to LitFam. And save the free and open internet. That's important too. I also want to quickly note before I end that I recognize that this is kind of a United States specific problem. So if you're international, let me know what cable companies and ISPs are like in your country in the comments down below. I talked with some of my YouTube friends from other countries, and it's really interesting to see how it all compares. Thanks for watching. If you want to help save net neutrality, click the I and be sure to hit that like button and share this video to make sure people are informed. DFTBA and explore on.
Mr. Pie in the Face has basically ascended to anime supervillain at this point. You're a partisan hack, dude!
That's just like your opinion, man. We good?
We're good.
Thanks, guys. Right. Anyone have my coffee? All right.
Check out this sponsor transition. To access the internet, you may need a phone. And if you have a phone, you know what you need? A screen protector! Boom, nailed it! Thank you to ESR for sponsoring this video. They make a ton of cool cases and cables, but today they want me to talk about their screen protectors. They've got screen protectors for basically every iPhone you can think of, as well as some Galaxy phones and even some iPads. They sent me a screen protector for the iPhone 8, and let me just say, this is some quality glass. It's 5 times stronger than the glass on your phone. They have anti-fingerprint coating that lasts for a full year, and it's super easy to set up. Click the link in the description to check them out and get yours today. If you're still watching this video, then hopefully you liked it, so it's really helpful to press that like button and subscribe if you haven't already. If you like videos on business, check out Why the iPhone is So Popular and No Snapchat Won't Fail by clicking the end cards on screen right now. Thank you to my patrons over at patreon.com/technicality, especially the ones on screen right now. See y'all next time. Weird outro transition with my arms, woo!